Hi, welcome to the signal path. Check out what I have scored from a dumpster dive. These are elements from a particular type of spectrum analyzer and optical component analyzer that I found in a dumpster I was going through. And these actually go into a really big and heavy module. I didn't bring the module with me because I'm not really intending to fix it. This is a big, bulky instrument, but I am more very interested in taking it apart and salvaging some cool microwave components from it. And perhaps if there is enough time, we would even test some of those microwave components. As you can imagine, for an old HP unit like this, those components will be rather hard to find, and they may come in handy in a future repair. And I'm sure there is tons of cool stuff to see inside these and to play around with and to learn about the architecture. So, as I said, this is from a light wave component analyzer and spectrum analyzer. So you can see on the left there is a tracking generator component, and this one goes from 20 hertz to 2.9 gigahertz, which is also pretty interesting because normally tracking generators don't start at such a low frequency. It's difficult to make decoupling caps and so on at the output, and the fact that it is AC coupled, or at least has the option of being AC coupled, is interesting. Although it could be that when it's AC coupled, it doesn't go down to 20 hertz. I'm not sure, I haven't looked at the data sheet, but nonetheless pretty cool to look at it. Here's the main RF section, and this is where the down conversion happens. The spectral down conversion actually happens. You can see it only has one RF input in the front, and it's also DC coupled because it says it has 0 volt maximum. But what is really cool about this particular one, as I happen to know from before, is that this one I believe does direct frequency down conversion. So none of that noisy subharmonic mixing. It's direct mixing, which means it has to have some capability to generate very high signals because this works up to 22 gigahertz. So I'm pretty excited about what we can get out of this. Most likely a Yig oscillator at the very high frequencies, which is pretty cool. Those things are already quite expensive as they are. And of course, you know, saving these things is cool because otherwise this would have ended up in the landfill anyway. It's good for the environment, and whatever component I save can then save another instrument from ending up in the landfill. And the next one is where the actual light wave section is, and this is where optoelectronic conversion happens. It has an optical input, and this works from 1200 to 1600 1200 to 1600 nanometers, so it covers a really wide band of optical channels. And it has also an RF input, so you can do a direct electrical test as well. But the optical input gets converted to an RF output in a detector, and then you can connect that RF output direct to the RF input, and voila, you got an optical spectrum analyzer. By optical spectrum analyzer, I mean analyzing the signal once it's converted to the electrical domain. An optical spectrum analyzer can actually measures the optical power. It's a different, very, very different instrument, an entirely different mechanism of operation. I have hinted on that in a different video that I did about wavelength analyzers. And finally, here I have a frequency reference, which of course you can imagine what's in here. And because it has an oven cold and so on and on written on it, I believe this is a 10 megahertz and a 100 megahertz oven controlled crystal in there. So I'm pretty excited to get that. Even that itself would be pretty useful. And these are really, really heavy and pretty long units. You can appreciate them from this angle. So let me show you. There you go. There we go. So you can see these are very big. And what do I have here to compare it with? Here we go, let's compare with my beer. That I'm about to have. So there you go, let me turn the camera a little bit. There it is, so you can imagine this thing is pretty gigantic. And there must be a lot of different components in here. And there's a bunch of switches of access in here. Remember, the display is not here. I don't have the display module. I wasn't going to carry that. That thing weighted, my God, it weighted as much as I did. And so you can see it's pretty long. Let's take a look at the back of this. And here at the back, you can get an idea of how this thing interfaced with the mainframe that it was installed in. Here you can see connectors where the power was inserted, and you can see the middle of the connector, there's a 3-pin alignment section here so that, you know, it doesn't get inserted in a crooked way and break the pins. So here where the data and power would go in, for example, this thing had a GPIO interface also. All the other ports at the back, the reference outputs, the intermediate, the IF output. This is a heterodyne converter, of course, so the IF output comes out of here. A bunch of synchronization, for example, the LO sync goes in here so that the tracking generator can be phase locked and frequency locked to whatever else is in there. So pretty awesome. I'm very excited in taking it apart, and I thought, hey, let's do this on camera. I'm sure you would enjoy it as well. And we're going to start with the simple one, just because it's probably the easiest to open and it's the smallest one. Let's get ourselves started with the frequency reference and go from there. Well, check it out. This is the frequency reference board. It was really easy to open. The panels literally just shift off, and they actually have a little notch that closes them up. So it's really, really clean and compact, actually. And what is really cool, I just, you know, that's the very first thing to take a look at is obviously we were expecting to see a crystal, and in fact we do. But check it out. This thing is on shock absorbers. It's got this plastic sections here, which are keeping this thing essentially floating. And this is, of course, to protect it against vibration in case this is dropped or some shaking, and to keep it really, really precise and not have any drift, because obviously shock damages the crystal and also it can make it drift. So really, really cool. I don't know if I've that was the last time I've ever seen it like this, something like that. Pretty crazy. And here's an empty section. This empty section is actually is an option that this thing can have for an external amplifier distributor, so you can have multiple outputs. You can see these points here are not populated. You can have multiple outputs here. By the way, this has an external power input in addition to everything else, perhaps a clean input power for to make sure that the PLL has a quiet power supply. That could be one reason. And a couple of shielded cans here, which I will of course open. And on the other side, we got more of the same thing. Here's the back of that. And here's another shielded section, another amplifier option that's missing. This is the power cable. You can see the cables coming in from the connector over there. Everything nice and neat and compact, a bunch of selectable switches. And this is, I think this is supposed to also have 100 megahertz as well. It can also work at 100 megahertz. But let's go ahead and take the cans off to look what's underneath, and then we can talk about the circuits, and then we'll take it apart and save what is useful. Here we go, let's start with this side. Something interesting to note here as well is that they obviously shield all the digital section as well. It makes sense that you don't want the digital switching components to leak out. So it's not just protecting stuff from getting in, it's also obviously protecting stuff from getting out. And you can see the firmware I see here. There is another UV erasable I see here, perhaps some other component for storing a memory or program or process RAM. You know, I don't want to go into details too much of these things. Not very interesting. A couple of other ICs, not too interesting to go through the data sheet. It's just mostly looking at the architecture and the way it's designed. And it's also cool to note that the RF ground actually ends in the middle of here. So this thing has a completely isolated digital ground, as you would expect. This shield that you see around it with the stitching of the ground plane going all the way through the PCB does not go underneath these ICs, as opposed to here where it's exposed. The actual surface of the copper pore is exposed everywhere else. And this is a gold, could actually be gold plated, I'm not 100% sure. But it's interesting to see the fact that the way they've done the shielding, and also the fact that this doesn't have a silkscreen. This board is completely and completely exposed, and it's very, very shiny and very pretty. So on the other side, we have more of the RF elements, and these are protected by these cans, of course, with a conductive gasket that will create a good shield, not just electronically, but also against moisture as well. So it keeps everything out. Again, here, no silkscreen. You can see the camera and some of the lights on the ceiling. So you can follow up a little bit of the architecture here. A bunch of, again, this has a PLL in it, don't forget that, it doesn't just rely on that. So the 100 megahertz signal internally is likely produced by the PLL itself, which is then locked to this 10 megahertz reference. So this is the reference for the PLL. Just to be sure, sorry, it's out of the camera. Yep, it has a 100 megahertz output. Indeed, apologize again. I just wanted to make sure which one it is, and it's this one. So this is the 100 megahertz output. In fact, coming from this thing. So there is definitely a PLL in here, so they have multiple sections. I can tell you that this is the lucky candidate for the oscillator, because again, it has a varactor diode there, and this transistor likely is either a transistor, an amplifier, or a core of a VCU of some kind. There's a bunch of other coils around here. This could be there, for example, on the tank. In fact, I'm pretty sure this is on the tank of the VCO, or it could be the choking inductor at the output. Just a couple of different ideas, and these were all shielded by these things. So from the perspective here, really the only thing to save from this board, I would, you know, guess, is just the oscillator itself. I don't think much from this can be useful. But what I will do is that I will save these boards. If you guys see something that you think is interesting on the video, or if you even want one of these pieces, let me know, and we'll see what we can do about it, and figure out how we can do this. I might also take a look at what this part is and save it. So I'll take this out and let's move to another board. It's too bad that the options are not installed, because I could have definitely used these amplifier chains, because this is essentially a board with an RF at the input, and then it will distribute the RF and coming out. That could have been pretty useful. It's too bad that it's not in there. And a quick assembly. And here we are, our little oscillator. Look at that. This is the whole unit. So I'll try and power this on later at a different time. For now, let's get all everything that's actually useful out of here. And this thing was actually made in the United States back then. And I actually found out what this was. I hadn't paid close attention because I couldn't see the label at the top. This says 100 on it and with six zeros in front of it. So it's obviously a 100 megahertz oscillator, but it is externally tunable, perhaps with these varactor diodes. And that's how they make the PLL. So they have the oscillator, perhaps the charge pump phase detector, all that good stuff. I'll have to do a tutorial on PLLs some other time. I'm sure it will be an interesting one. So there you go. We are pretty much done with this one. And let's go to another module. All right, here's the optoelectronic converter section. And what a score. Not only does this have a 22 gigahertz optoelectronic converter, it also has a mechanical attenuator and a power optical power meter built into it. This is a pretty awesome. So here's the at this point is where the optical input comes in, and it goes into here. You can actually take this cover off, where it is based likely on free space optics. And here's a motor in here, and this motor then adjusts the attenuation by changing either the angle of a particular component or changing the polarization of an optical filter in there. But anyhow, I have to open up to know exactly how it works, but it's pretty cool, because now I have access to an optical system. So you can imagine the optical signal coming in, the wavelength coming in, goes through the attenuator and then somehow bounces inside this can. And in here is where the photodetector, a broadband photodetector, 22 gigahertz modulation bandwidth. I'm super excited to have something like this added to the lab. And you've seen optical attenuators before, and happen to be my Anritsu one is right here. I used it in one of the previous videos, so we've seen it before, but I'm pretty excited. So here's the top of it. You can see here it says this is a Hewlett Packard particular type of it says an optical electronic converter, just like I said. RF output 100 kilohertz to 26.5 gigahertz. Really cool. And then this is a multi-board construction. It's pretty dense, actually, as you can imagine. It's three different boards in there connected all together via board-to-board connections and so on. And there's a whole bunch of other connectors inside, which I guess are not used. Here's a battery for some retention of some data, and it hasn't leaked out at all, even though it's quite old. I'm pretty nice and impressed with that. You have to be rather careful with taking apart these things, because obviously you can damage them. So I want to keep this intact so we can test it and play with it later. Oh, there's another pretty big score in here. Look at that. I don't know if you can tell or not from the angle you're looking at, but there it is right here. These two components here, if you don't recognize them, they're microwave relays. And since they are feeding from 26.5 gigahertz, these are 26.5 gigahertz microwave relays. Really awesome, cool for different types of experiments. Obviously, they're microwave relays, so they're not solid state. They have very high repeatability. They have very, very little insertion loss. They're pretty cool, and they're really easy to use. So I'm excited to get those out of there as well. So overall, a really cool score, and to save this and to see this component and use it later will be cool. So I'm gonna go ahead and take a couple of screws. Let's take these boards out and find a good, safe way of taking this portion out of this. I took the brackets off of this. This is a neat little thing. This is actually two boards assembled together. So this is either an upgrade module or some firmware module. Let's take it out, see if I can do that. Of course, look how beautifully it's designed. I mean, the attention to detail, every little single thing just works perfectly. Look at that. Oh, so beautiful. This thing is, this is definitely a firmware upgrade section. You can see a whole bunch of UV erasable EEPROMs in there, and a couple of interesting that they use a different package underneath it, and perhaps it's missing some component here. So obviously this is something that you could take out and upgrade, and then it interfaces with the rest of the board. There's really not much we can do with this aside from look at the wonderful engineering and the thought that's gone into it. There we go, managed to get this this board out, which had the sweep output at the back. Again, very simple board. Something interesting to note, however, here is that this is a trace of the analog input at the back. I forget what it was. Let me see. Let me just remind myself. It's the high sweep in and out port. So here you can see the trace in the middle trapped between two floating pieces of metal. This is actually not ground. On this side, that's the ground. Kind of cool, huh? You can see the ground signal is much thicker, passed through. Protected between two plates that are not connected to anything else to shield it. Interesting way of doing that. And there you go, the rest of it is pretty straightforward. Nothing special, nothing fancy, just a basic board, a bunch of analog and digital stuff on it. So let's continue. Look at the interesting way this other board is connected to everything else. This is a board that had the option in the middle of it. And this is also the board that connects to the attenuator portion of the optical front input. And look at that, the way the power reaches this is actually two parallel, a really thick, a really wide metal strip ribbon cable. And this plugs into here like so. And this is actually doesn't carries as well as some digital signals. Obviously, the power, as you can tell by how thick it is. And if you pay close attention to this portion here, this board also came out. There you go. That's convenient. Look at this. This is where the power comes from, the cable from back there, and there is a ferrite core on there to filter and prevent EMI radiation. There it is. There you go. This is a very, very common technique where they put the two ferrite cores and they pass a signal right through that, and there's a mount for it. So this is, even this itself is kind of useful for different kind of things. Maybe in the future it can be used for protecting one of the projects that I've been working on. Maybe the optical monochromator can actually benefit this, because I actually do have ferrite cores on that for the stepper motor, and not to interfere with the rest of the functions, the sensitive analog voltages. So I could maybe use that for that as well. There you go. And then this just connects to where the power comes in at the back, which I've showed you before. Again, nothing fancy on this board. There's no point going through all the different ICs in there. Everything looks good. There's a crystal there, a whole bunch of comparators and different kinds of gates, a couple of custom components here, who knows what's there. Here's a battery, which looks good, and it's a bunch of selecting switches, little tiny LEDs, status LEDs, and some kind of a switch that I have no idea what it does, but other than that, pretty straightforward. Let's go. And here's our last board, and obviously dead giveaway that this is our converter, some kind of a supply converter, DC-DC converters, as well as regulators, nicely filtered, bigger capacitors here. Sorry if I'm moving these around, I'm excited to go forward. These are 2200 microfarad 10 volt electrolytic capacitors on there. Again, another filter here of some kind to filter the power supply, surely. And this is what actually drives the microwave filters in there too. And they're, I believe, 28 volts. Usually they are 28 volt filters. So it looks good. Now there's nothing left in here except for the fun things. And here you go. That's just like I mentioned to you. Wait, I don't want to bang my other instruments here. There we go. As I mentioned, these are... Oh, look at that! They are Teledyne! Woohoo! Teledyne microwave switches, and made in the USA. They have two ports. This is very common. This is the common port of the microwave switch, and then it either switches this way or that way. And then there's a DC voltage that you apply here, and you can see that it actually shows you which one is going to be connected depending on. Which one is going to be connected on depending on which one you're applying a voltage to. And these are going to be 22, at least 22 gigahertz microwave switches. I don't believe it's set on it, but if you look at it, you can see there you go. See, 24 to 30 volts. Usually run them at 28 or 24 volts. So it looks good. I'm going to go ahead and take these components out, and we can again take this out and put it aside. I'm not going to test it right away, but they're definitely going to look at this. First, I want to get all the teardowns out of the way and then see what we can do next. So just while I do this, I wanted to share another little tiny piece of information with you. You can see that these microwave switches are actually connected to the everything else using these rigid cables. Now, you may be tempted to save these rigid cables. And you could, and obviously they're rigid, a little bit more difficult to use. But one of the reasons I typically don't save these and I throw them away is because these rigid cables obviously aren't very good once you bend them out of shape, because the characteristic impedance of the cable will drastically change as you keep bending it. And it becomes rather not very suitable if you want to do any other kind of sensitive measurements. And, you know, buying cables like this is actually cheap these days. You can buy SMA cables fairly easily, although these are better than SMA. They're most likely K cables, K connectors on them, because they have to work up to 26 gigahertz or so. So they're more likely better than that. But anyhow, something to share with you. And these are very difficult to take apart, obviously. But let me take this and we can take a closer look at the microwave switch. But typically, I wouldn't really save these. And microwave switches, and like I said, K compatible connectors. Very nice, and these things came off, and here's an example of one of the cables I took off. Anyhow, I'm usually going to throw these away, and wow, these are quite rigid actually, which is great, because when they are this rigid, they're extremely, extremely stable, both in phase and in amplitude. So phase stable rigid cables, good for doing S-parameters, but only if you keep it in this shape. And success, here's the entire optical portion here. So here's the stepper motor controller for the attenuator. Here is what I suspect is probably maybe a potentiometer to tell you what the location is, or some kind of an optical decoder. This may not be a stepper motor. I just said that outright, but I could be wrong. It's probably just a regular motor of some kind, because then otherwise I wouldn't know what this is. But anyhow, this is likely the photo detector, because this thing has an optical power meter. So this is most likely the output for that, because it's using a low frequency cable. That's my guess again. And so it has an output here, and it also has a rigid cable output. And this rigid cable output is what is listed as going up to 26.5 gigahertz for the optical modulators. So I'm a little bit puzzled about actually what this one is. It could be that this is the I was so excited to take it apart, I didn't pay attention what this was connected to. But anyway, it's not on camera, so I can always go back and look. But I bet you're dying to see what's under this cover, because we can see exactly what's in here. Oh, look, there's a little window. How cool is that? Oh my goodness, that is some window, perhaps for alignment during manufacturing. Really cool, because this is not facing anything else. In fact, it's facing this. This must be some kind of a monitor alignment port. Very cool. I didn't notice it before. So anyhow, we'll take a look at this at a different time. Right now, I'm going to move on to the next module. And here we have the tracking generator. And look how awesome it is. It's got lots and lots of microwave components and amplifiers and attenuators and mixers and so on, which we can use for other projects. I just took it apart, so I'm going to brainstorm here with you guys, but I'm really excited. So let's get started with this. So this is, as I mentioned, a 2.9 gigahertz tracking generator, but the LO input that synchronizes it actually is at a higher frequency, and the LO input is from 3 gigahertz to 6.6 gigahertz, and you can in fact see that if I can lift it onto the camera a little bit. Here we go. Here's the LO input from 3 to 6 gigahertz, and actually the output of it is available from the back, which here is looped back again into the unit, which then I believe then would come from the front of the unit. I think the set of modules that I have is actually not the complete set of modules, and there are more different types of modules that you can use in a full system that has everything in it for, let's say, optoelectronic analyzers and so on. So I don't have everything, but nonetheless, we can trace the signal here and figure out what it's doing. And because the LO signal coming into the unit is at quite a different frequency than the tracking generator output, it's going to have a mixer in it too. So let's take a look. Here's the LO input coming in. And you can see the LO input going through this rigid cable, and then goes through this unit, which I believe is either an isolator or a circulator. And then the output of that goes into this, which I'm really excited about. Let me give you a quick look at it. And let me see if I can focus. There it is. I'm sorry that it's upside down. It's a leveling amplifier, which is really awesome. Not only does it have an auxiliary LO output here, which is terminated right now, but it also has a built-in pin diode attenuator control, and it also has an LO sense. And because it has both of those functions built into it, what we can do with it is we can build an AGC, which is an automatic gain control amplifier, which I believe is what is used in this case. So we can make an amplifier whose output power is kept at a constant power, despite no matter what the input power is, for a particular range, the range the amplifier attenuator supports and so on. So why do they have this? Well, I suspect they have this because you don't know who's gonna, what's gonna be connected here in terms of power. You don't know what kind of cable is gonna be connected. Maybe it's gonna be a long cable, a short cable. So the input power to the LO port of this is rather unknown. But you want to make sure that you give a constant LO power to the mixer, which is right here, so that the conversion gain of the mixer is calibrated and predictable. So I believe that's why they have this here, so that if there is a range of attenuation at the LO signal, this will adjust the power and give you a constant power. So the output then goes back out of here, and then I lost track of it. Here it is. So here's the input, goes through here. Here's the output, goes back through here, goes into another circuitor or isolator, then goes into the LO port of this first converter. And then on top of that, we have the RF of this first converter going through a filter, which then goes through around here, and then I believe comes out of the back here from this loop that I showed you here. And then the IF signal actually comes from its own internal synthesizer, which then comes out of here and it goes through a microwave cavity filter. This is what I believe this is. And then the output of that is taken into another amplifier. And this amplifier is then at the frequency of the tracking generator. And this is an amplifier up to 3.6 gigahertz. It also has a detector output, so you can actually measure the power that's coming out, which is pretty awesome. It doesn't have a detector in it. It doesn't have a pin attenuator in it, so therefore you cannot build an AGC out of this one so easily. But nonetheless, and then this cavity filter again is interesting because it has four screws in the center labeled LO adjust, IF adjust 3, 2, and 1, which I believe you can adjust the cavity filter center frequencies and so on, which again, I think that's what this is from the shape of it. I've done a tutorial on cavity filters before, so you can see what, you know, the inside of something like this looks like, and this kind of resembles that to me. And anyhow, so then this is the full picture of what's over here, so we can salvage an AGC, a bunch of isolators, a filter, a converter, an amplifier, a microwave filter, awesome, and a whole bunch of other cables. Again, I said I don't really use these cables, but you know, some of the long straight ones might be okay. And then from the top, we can see again what we have, a whole bunch of different PCBs in there. Of course, lots of blue attenuators, a whole bunch of blue potentiometers, and a lot of cabling that some poor person has had to so beautifully and nicely and neatly put together. Again, we can see how much thought has gone into it, not just from the circuit design perspective, but also from just mechanical engineering perspective. All these things have to be, you know, these are all custom machine aluminum parts. All the cables are hand-bent to the particular shape for this unit, so these things must have cost a fortune. And again, components, beautiful. If they work, I'd be very, very happy. And what else do we have here? Here I recognize from this little exposed area that we have a mechanical step attenuator in here, which is pretty awesome too, because these things, again, have very low insertion loss. They're extremely repeatable, and they're mechanical. They're not solid state attenuators, so we can extract that as well. Here's the main synthesizer board. It's labeled VCXO. So it's a voltage-controlled crystal oscillator in here, which I believe will be the ultimately what it generates the main frequencies, which then is mixed with the mixer that I just showed you. And I am sure there is a whole bunch of other things in here which I cannot see right now. At the bottom part, there is nothing. It's just closed. So really, really awesome. I kind of feel bad taking it apart because it is so nicely put together, but I think the components can be put into better use. Here we go. I've made a little bit of progress, taking some of the cables off. So now this module comes off separately. This is the first converter. Very nice. Again, you can see that these are all what appear to be hermetically sealed packages, most likely from a 3-5 type technology. I'm not sure what they are made of. Maybe gallium nitride or indium phosphide. I mean, who knows? I have to take a look closer to find out. We can further disassemble this, of course. We can take the connector off. There you go. Somebody had over-tightened that, but at the factory, here we go. These probably have never been disassembled once they are assembled. By the way, I'm EST protected, in case you're wondering. You don't want to touch these things unless you're not. There we go. Yeah, this is, I'm fairly sure now that I see the back of this, this must be a circulator. I wish we can test actually this later at a different time. And these connectors are, of course, also useful. You know, here's an SMA. 2 SMA, male-to-male connector, and it's obviously going to be very good quality coming from HP. And there you go, these things are quite expensive, as you can imagine, so I'm pretty happy to be getting so many components out of this. And I'd be very interested in characterizing this mixer. There's an interesting screw here, I wonder what's that used for. Anyhow, so let me continue disassembling some more, and then let me show you this first. Here you go, I use our filter, and it's interesting to note, look, this is where the cable was connected, so you can see the body of it is made of aluminum, and now the discoloration from where the connector is no longer connected to the unit. Oops, sorry, I'm moving this too much. Here we go, you can see the oxidization. You can see how well the connector is protected against moisture and oxygen presence and so on once it's screwed in, protecting, making good electrical contact at higher frequencies as well. So again, this can be easily measured either with a network analyzer or with a tracking generator spectrum analyzer. It's kind of funny to measure something that came from a tracking generator with another tracking generator. So anyhow, we'll do this at a different time. Look at this, somebody had assembled this by hand, and I just disassembled it with my hands, and if by an extreme coincidence whoever assembled this is watching, I want to apologize for what I have done, but I have to disassemble the back of this in order to be able to get all the other units out of it, and lots of connectors to salvage and lots of cables to salvage, you know, even a panel mountable SMA to SMA converters, you know, these are very useful, and they can be used forever. It's too bad these things end up in the garbage. Who knows how many of these things are thrown away every day. But anyhow, let's keep going. Look at the attention to detail here. Look at how carefully these cables are assembled. They have coupling to ground capacitors, and on them they have ferrite cores individually wrapped around each cable to absorb as much of the noise as possible, and do not allow interference between the lines. I mean, every little thing, even this little tiny thing, is twist tied together. It's amazing, and this amount of work is actually done to build something like this. I'm curious about how much this cost when it was new. If someone knows, let me know. But I'm almost out. I'm almost ready to get out the AGC unit. So all the cables that go in and out of the different converter units, for example, or different modules, actually have little labels connected to them, and those labels are written on top here. Both the connector type and the color is written there so that someone can assemble them. So that's how they keep track of these type of things, and we've seen this thing before, that they do this, and it makes it obviously a lot easier. And these are all the analog, low speed analog signals, SMB connectors and so on going around. Pretty neat. All right, we are in. We took a bunch of the stuff out. So here is one of the units that I was pretty happy to have. So here, as you can see, 3 GHz to 6.6 GHz. This is likely a tuned amplifier. And look, it has the label on actually on both sides. And there's a termination resistor here where the auxiliary LO is. So there must be a splitter in there, probably an active splitter with the pin diode and everything. So the cables had to be cut. But I'm going to preserve it like this. So that's one really good find. And here's the closer look at the amplifier, the 3.6 GHz amplifier, and it looks really, really nice also. I'm going to take it apart and take a look at it later, but again, we save the cables as much as possible. And I also realized where the other converter was. Here's a third converter module. You can see it's a microwave module again, completely closed. We'll take the cap off of this as well. So the first converter you already saw, that was this one. And here's the third converter, and there's a second converter somewhere else. So there it is. Looks nice. It's got a bunch of adjustment points here and there, and we'll take a look at that afterwards. And I also managed to get the entire digital section out, so you can see it's fully self-contained. I can see a fuse through there. Again, it has a section where all the DC power is handled. These are all the connectors that were at the back of the unit. All these cables used to connect to those points. And some more ribbon cables in here. I'll take these boards out so we can take a look at it. You can see some firmware ICs deep in there and so on. And again, very simple, all through hole, nothing surface mount on it. I'm looking for a date. I don't see one immediately, obviously, but anyhow, looks pretty cool. So let's go ahead and take this little thing apart as well and continue disassembling. So this is the bottom of the three boards, and obviously this is the power supply board. You can tell clearly that this is the distribution of power that they do from the connectors back here to everywhere else, powers everything else, and they use these low profile electrolytic capacitors that we saw in the other units as well. So obviously they all use the same distributor for these. A bunch of transformers and so on for switching power supplies, a bunch of bridges, obviously the fuse you see here, nicely heat synced different transistors and regulators, and look how neat this board is, and obviously has a full copper pour that covers the entire top of the board. I'm not going to take it out of this case, but you can see the back of it very nice, clean, thicker lines for high current nodes and so on. Very nicely done, and you know, I'm not gonna salvage any parts from these. These things are quite inexpensive compared to the microwave components. The heat sinks are kind of nice to use for something. Maybe I'll take those off. But other than that, I'm not gonna do much with this one. And here is the firmware version board. It's all the digital components go on here. And you can tell there's a bunch of UV erasable components on here. And the date can be seen. At least the date for the firmware is 1987. Wow, I was what, five or six years old at that time. So it's this thing is quite old. There's a little filter they have manually made with a ferrite core. There are some unpopulated components. Again, some custom parts obviously made for this. A bunch of UV erasable components, as I said before. Pretty straightforward digital board. They have done a copper pour here, obviously some grounding, a special grounding here that they needed to have a solid ground plane for whatever reason. I don't quite remember what this portion was actually connected to, but it's a, you know, empty connector. So they, whenever there wasn't anything, they actually put empty connectors in there to not have any exposed copper. Clever again, because you saw all those cables and these are sharp. They most likely didn't want these to poke into other cables. So by putting something in here to block it, you can make sure that that doesn't happen. You know, very nice, clever, simple solution to that little problem. And this is probably for other options and things like that. And if you're wondering what this hole is, this hole actually lined up with the big transformer here. So that's another board. Again, not much to do with it except to look at it. And this last board here obviously has some analog components on it. This is the board that had the array of potentiometers on it, and this is used to control the LO board, obviously, because you can see there are labels written on top of it talking about LO level and, you know, different type of slopes and so on and gain controls and things like that. So this obviously controls the converter and the synthesizer board that's in there. I know there's not much you really can do with these boards, although I did notice some component here which I didn't immediately recognize. At first I thought it was a reed switch, but of course it's not, and I don't know what it is. Maybe you can guess, maybe some kind of a diode, but anyhow, interesting. So let's go take a look at the rest. And here's our VCXO. You can see that it's fully self-contained and closed. We will open this as well, so I'll put this aside for now. And at this point, you can see, ooh, there's our second converter. Here is the mechanical attenuator I was talking about. So that's embedded here. These things are very, very useful if you have a mechanical attenuator controller, which I actually do. So I can use this for some other purpose. You can see another ferrite core filtering done here very nicely with this cable around it. There's another component here, which I can't tell what it is from this angle, but I'm very excited to find that. Here's another converter. So we continue disassembling and getting these neat components out of here. There it is. Here's the step attenuator, 70 dB, and it doesn't say the frequency, but surely this thing at least works up to 4 or 5 gigahertz. So I'm pretty happy with this, and it has a, you know, intact cable, and it's quite easy to run these. There's just 24 volt array of relays in here with different attenuation levels. These are obviously resistive attenuation with the mechanical relays that closes and opens different ratios of resistors. Very basic unit, but extremely repeatable, and I don't know how much usage this has had, because these obviously have a certain number of steps before they start to deteriorate. But again, because they are resistive dividers, the OIP3 is very, very, very high, so extremely linear, obviously, for essentially completely linear, and are very good. So I'm pretty excited to get one of these. I have actually a few of these, but you can never have enough of these things. There we go. Now I know what this is, and check it out. This is a directional detector, and it has the cable intact. This is actually the only component so far that I've taken that I don't have in my lab. I have some kind of it. I don't have a directional detector, but these things are quite EST sensitive, and in fact, there was a label in there too, attached to the other side of it, saying that this is the detectors, the pin detectors in here, the diode detectors are very, very EST, quite EST sensitive. So anyhow, you gotta be very careful with these things to make sure that they don't get damaged. But so far so good. The only thing left to take out is the other converter. And here is our second converter with the 300 megahertz input, and of course the IF and the second LO output. So these things are obviously in a super heterodyne configuration. I've talked about that before. Very cool that this is in built in one piece. and the microwave filter is directly on top of this, and adjustments are here at the top. So pretty cool, and that's what I'm pretty sure that's what this is. So yeah, it turned out this is the last piece out of here. And there it is. There's the sad empty portion of it with the front connector. There's actually a type N to SMA converter connector here too, which is useful, so I'll try and salvage that. A couple of SMAs, the BNCs to these SMB connectors here, so I'll salvage that too. But other than that, there's nothing really left in here. And yeah, so we're gonna go ahead and I'm gonna clean this mess up, and then we're going to move on to the final unit. And here's the last one. This is the RF section, and it is dense and packed with a whole bunch of other microwave components. I can already see another attenuator, 70 dB attenuator in there already, and there's a bunch of other components in here. Something which I thought could be a gig oscillator, but maybe I'm wrong, but I have to take a look closely to it. And at the back of it, we can see another second converter and a last converter module. This is obviously, again, another multiple conversion, but at least based on what I knew about this unit, it should have a fundamental converter as the main front-end converter, which then converts to a reasonably low IF frequency. So that should be interesting to find as well. I think the way to disassemble this is take this board off, and then we can see all the microwave components in there, and that should be fairly easy going from there. So let's go ahead, take a look. Let me show you something here. Take a look at this. I took the screws off, and this is actually on hinges, obviously intended to be serviced. And take a look at this. Just look at that. This thing is so beautiful. I cannot in my right mind destroy this. This would make such a beautiful display piece in your home, you know, under, let's say, a glass coffee table. It's such a great conversation piece, and it's just too beautiful to destroy. I cannot take this one apart. The other ones, you couldn't really see the internals, but this is almost made to be presented. But nonetheless, we can still go through it. I hope you don't mind that I'm not gonna take this one apart. It's, like I said, it's just too wonderful. So it has an LO input. The LO input that's coming from the outside to this system is from 3 to 6 GHz. Obviously, at the same LO that would have gone onto the tracking generator, it goes into this one as well. And there is an LO leveling system here, just like there was in the other one. And then it goes from the LO leveling output. So this is an amplifier to give you a constant LO signal. It goes into this, and this is an LO multiplier. So when I said that there was a gig oscillator to generate the signal, there isn't actually, and they accomplished that with the external LO going into a multiplier. So the signal going in comes out at 3 to 6.56 gigahertz, and what comes out is 3 to 22.3 gigahertz, and it's configurable filters and so on. Then it goes into the main down converter, the full, the direct converter at the fundamental frequency. And I remember I said there was a yaw oscillator, where I wasn't that off. There's actually a Yig filter. So this is a Yig filter in there. And remember, Yig filter is a yttrium iron garnet material. And that material changes the electric constant in the presence of magnetic field. And it's tuned by coils, just like a Yig oscillator is. So there's in fact coils inputs here. So there is indeed a Yig tuned filter to give exactly the response you want, to give that, to get a really sharp high quality factor resonance circuit in there to give the filtering necessary to move around as you please in the band that you want to do the down conversion. And then it goes through an attenuator. So actually I should have start from this one. So here's the input, goes through a step attenuator to the mixer, and here's the LO coming in. And then once the signal IF comes out, then the IF goes into the second converter and third converter, but then it's already essentially very, very close to DC compared to 22 gigahertz, only at 300 and something megahertz. Here's another filter here. Here's my mind is skipping, another isolator, a circulator, there you go, and a circulator in here to have to make sure the signal only flows in one direction. And it just, like I said, it's just beautiful. Look at it. You just sit like this, and how can you look at this and not ask, well, what the heck is it? So I'm going to keep this one the way it is. We have a bunch of great components from the other ones that we can use, and I'm going to save this this wonderful one for some kind of a display. But anyhow, we know roughly how it works now, and let me show you all the other things that we took out. And here we go. These are all the great components that I managed to get out of these couple of units that I think will be useful for future. And I talked a little bit about all of them. And I'm interested to hear from you guys if it's something that you want me to follow up on, because I can talk about the ASIC design that goes into different things. I can talk about the microwave design that goes into making these things and then test them and characterize them individually and talk about them as I go ahead and do that. Obviously, that's going to take some time. So, you know, if there's good interest in it, then I'll try and do it. So leave me a message or a comment on there. Let me know what you think. And again, I didn't take apart the last one. Sorry about that. But it will be useful for some other things. And as always, if you enjoy the video and you learned something from it, make sure you leave a comment and give it a thumbs up, perhaps, because it will allow the video to be shared more often and the YouTube will rank it, and it would allow it to reach more people. And as you know, that's the only reason why I do this, and no other reason for that. So this will help create better discussions and other people commenting on it, which we can all learn from. So until next time.